It's time for Tiger Talk on the Tiger Sports Network. Tiger Talk, live from Big Smoke Barbecue on the corner of 8th and Main in Hayes. A distinctly local take on classic American barbecue. Order online at BigSmokeHayes.com. Tiger Talk is also brought to you by these premier Tiger sponsors. Golden Belt Bank of Hayes and Ellis. Banking one story at a time. The Hayes Med Orthopedic Institute. Expertise, technology, compassion, all right here. Adams Brown, Strategic Allies and CPAs. Going above plus beyond for you. BTI, your John Deere dealer in Buckland, Great Bend, Greensburg, Hoxie, Mess City, and Pratt. BTI, our family in partnership with your family. The Taco Shop. Dine in, carry out, or delivery. You've never had it so good. And Eagle Communications. Our community connected. Now, the voice of the Tigers, Gerard Welbrock.
And a good Monday afternoon. Welcome into Tiger Talk on this balmy Monday. We're glad to have you aboard. We'll be talking some Fort Hays State basketball for the next hour. Women's coach Tony Hobson, men's coach Mark Johnson joining us. We're live at Big Smoke Barbecue at the corner of 8th and Main in Hayes. Love to see you out here. Of course, you can always get your to-go orders on this cold Monday at BigSmokeHayes.com. They're open Monday through Saturdays, 11 to 8 for lunch and for dinner. Joy some great barbecue. Fort Hays State Tigers at home this past week. They're getting set to hit the road for another Thursday-Saturday road swing. They'll be in Wichita on Thursday taking on the Newman Jets, and then Saturday afternoon in Edmond, Oklahoma to take on the Broncos of Central Oklahoma. Again, a reminder that you can chime in with a question here on the program. All you have to do is go to the Fort Hays State Athletics website, FHSUathletics.com. Click on fans. You get the drop down, and there in the very bottom, you'll see Ask the Coach. Submit a question. If we use it, you'll be in the running for a $25 gift certificate for food here at Big Smoke Barbecue in Hayes. And we've had a few questions about it. We'll go ahead and remind you, you can always sync up our radio broadcast with the MIAA TV network feed when the Tigers are on the road. All you have to do, if you don't have the TuneIn app on your mobile device or your tablet, download the TuneIn app. That's where you can listen to us. Look for Mix 103 KJLS. Make that one of your favorites. And then when you're watching the game on Thursday, whichever of the two is ahead, you pause it right before tip-off. When the second device catches up, you unpause, and there you go. You'll be synced up, and you can listen to the Tiger radio broadcast with the MIAA TV network feed. Fort Hays State women, a split over the week. They had a heartbreaking one-point double overtime loss to Missouri Western, and then came back and got a gritty one-point win over Northwest Missouri State. And with that, we welcome in the coach of the Fort Hays State women, Tony Hobson. And, boys, also close to being a great week. It just shows you basketball. It can be a it's an interesting game, and two one-point games, completely different feel. But just your thoughts on the week, and just the range of emotions after you go through a couple of games like that.
Well, not just from game to game, but I mean within a game.
Yeah.
I think on the Thursday game we were sky high three or four times, thinking we had the game in hand, and then you have the lows about three or four times thinking you've lost it, and it was just back and forth. I mean, it was a high intensity game. We got dug ourselves in a little bit of a hole and did a great job of getting out of it, and I thought second half just showed a lot of character on coming back and taking the lead. Katie had a great second half. Man. You know, she doesn't score the first half, has 20, and ends up with 17 boards. She played her heart out. Same, Olivia had a good, solid game. And Sydney Galladay made a bunch of plays down the stretch that were really clutch. Two free throws at the end of each two stanzas, you know, that put us into the next overtime or into overtime, and then hits a possible game winner. You know, it just went back and forth, and we made some critical mistakes, but so did they. I mean, good defenses force that, pressure forces that, fatigue forces those things sometimes. So I was just happy the way our kids just kept battling back. And I mean, it's hard. Those things are very I don't know what the good word, disconcerting. I mean, it's hard to stay focused on what you're trying to do when these things, when you're so up, then down, then up, then down. And I mean, I thought we had the game. We had a good chance to win it in regulation. They ended up with the ball to win it, and we get a good stop. And then in first overtime, I think we have it won, or a good chance. We're up five with a minute and a half. We make a couple critical errors. Again, they have the ball to win it. We stop them. Then in the third over, or in the second overtime, they're up six. They think they have it won. Yeah. We make a great comeback, take the lead, and we were just unable to stop them that last time for a third time. So just a, you know, it's about as, it's a tough way to lose. And we need, you know, we needed it badly, but what do? You just, you hope that you're able to play that game on Saturday at a decent level. But it really, really wiped us out physically and mentally. And then you go into Saturday's game shorthanded. At 6 o'clock in the morning on Saturday morning, I was at the hospital with five of my players. Four of them had taken another one there, which so we got everybody up early that day, and so we played without Olivia. She was ill all night and severely dehydrated, and then find out that three of our guards were also under the weather, not feeling good. They got hit full blown on Saturday night, but they played and gave us 15, 18 minutes of something, you know, just being there. And if without that, we don't beat them. They didn't play very well, not up to their standards, but again, they showed and did what they could. So, we battled through that day. That was a, you know, and then you have, Sid and Katie and some of those kids who had played so many minutes on Thursday. Mm-hmm. And then again, now you're asking them to go heavy minutes on Saturday. So just a challenging week for our kids. I was really happy to see us get that one pulled out on Saturday. This team kind of seems like sometimes it can't catch a break. And you have to keep just going at it and hope that eventually we will, and it'll pay off. But definitely two exciting games. I could live with something a little more comfortable,
a little less excitement.
Anyway, it was a challenging week for our kids, but I really liked the way we showed some resiliency, especially on Saturday. And I thought we played well enough to win Thursday. Just a couple critical mistakes, but man, some fantastic offensive plays to keep us in the game. And I was happy to see that. You just hope you could have one less mistake.
And you look at this season, it's easy to just sit back and kind of have a pity party. What could have been so many close games where it's one possession away and you win a couple of more of those. And you know, it's a whole different outlook right now. And I guess that, you know, I'm sure as a coach becomes a challenge to not let your team get there. But it seems like this group is pretty good about that. And you just keep plugging, and there's a whole month of basketball left in the regular season. You've got the conference tournament. Still a lot of time to do some things and achieve a lot of the goals you have. It just makes it a little more – I guess that margin for error becomes less. But it would be easy just to kind of feel sorry about the way things have gone. But this team seems to be pretty good about not doing that.
Well, you just – in a situation like this, you just have to avoid the rearview mirror. You just forget about it if possible. And – It's not possible to totally forget about it, but you have to move on. Otherwise, you'll end up losing some games you shouldn't. And, you know, I mean, against Kearney, Katie had a shot she'll make 80% of the time.
We've seen her hit it about 80% since.
And she, I mean, that's her shot. And we easily should have won on Thursday. And right there, that puts us one game out and in good shape for the regional, in good shape, period. Now we're kind of up against it, and we know that. And all we can do is just prepare ourselves the best we can and give it what we have. And I know these kids will, so I'm not worried about that. We just have to try to get everybody back healthy. I haven't checked in since earlier this morning. We had one other one sick this morning that hadn't been sick over the weekend. So hopefully that runs its course and we can get back halfway halfway to full steam by Thursday. We'll see what happens.
And it seems like every year, doesn't matter, every team has a stretch where – and that's something about basketball. It's the time of the year. There's illness going around, and you're in such court, tight confines. You do so much together. It seems like once it hits, it's just got to run its course, and then you got to battle through that. It seems like it affects everybody at some point during the basketball season.
Well, it got Missouri Western, too. They had three kids sick for Kearney's game, and that was I was surprised by the margin.
Yeah.
And, Budgets played 10 minutes.
Yeah.
There was an extenuating circumstance there a little bit. So it was either we gave it to them or they gave it to us. But I'm saying they gave it to us.
There you go. We'll go with that. I want to ask you about the last play in which they scored the game winner. And I know you knew it was going to two people. And it's easy to say, defend that. And they made a nice pass over the top that you were close to tipping and just couldn't get it. Just talk about that last play and what you obviously would have hoped was not to get the shot or not get the pass. It's sometimes easier said than done to defend those things.
Well, it is. And, I mean, they had about three things that go wrong. All it takes is a tip. We had it covered reasonably well. Our mistake was we should have not we were going out to kind of deny Clark the ball. She doesn't shoot from out there. We should have just stayed back knowing she was going to back cut. And then we had her pinned under the glass. And, if you look at the play, she clearly traveled to get back on the right side of the basket, but that's not going to be called.
Happened a lot all night. I'll say it. You don't have to.
I don't have to. I can agree, though. And then we could have easily got her pinned under there and not, mm-hmm. so a lot of things. But it was just one of those things in the heat of the moment. We covered Budgets up going to the corner. We knew that would be option number one. And Clark was probably option number two, and they got it. They'd actually ran the same play earlier, and at the end of, I think, regulation.
I think so.
So it'd been 10 minutes, 20 minutes on real time away, and they'd ran the same thing, and we'd covered it up. So, unfortunately, we just they made a play at the end, and we couldn't stop at that time.
Well, the Tigers lose a heartbreaker on Thursday, but then come back and win a nail-biter. And Tony mentioned all the obstacles they were going up against and playing a really good Northwest team that had been playing some pretty good basketball. But the Tigers escaped there with a one-point win. We'll talk about that. We'll preview the week ahead, road games at Newman and Central Oklahoma. Tiger Talk is brought to you by Golden Belt Bank of Hayes and Ellis. Your life has a story. Golden Belt Bank of Hayes and Ellis wants to get to know that story. It's banking one story at a time. Golden Belt Bank. You can visit them at goldenbeltbank.com. We've got more Tiger Talk straight ahead on the Tiger Sports Network built by PwC. Races into the front court. 8 seconds left. Sydney will drive a banker. Good! 1.8 to go. Sydney Galladay gives the Tigers an 81-80 lead with 4.8 left. She took the inbound of the baseline and just sprinted up the floor and hit a floating one-hander off the backboard. Yeah, I thought that might get it done on Thursday night. Great play there by Sydney. She's been doing that so well here down the stretch. But unfortunately, as we talked about, Missouri Western gets the double overtime victory at Gross Memorial Coliseum, 82-81. Welcome back to Tiger Talk. We're at Big Smoke Barbecue at the corner of 8th and Main in Hayes. BigSmokeHayes.com. May not be able to get here for lunch, but hey, stop on by on your way home from work. Take some takeout and some great barbecue to warm you up on a cold Monday here in the Midwest. Tiger Talk brought to you in part today by The Taco Shop. Dine in, carry out, or fast delivery. It's The Taco Shop. You've never had it so good. We're talking Fort-Hays State women's basketball with Coach Tony Hobson. His squad coming off a split this week at home over Missouri Western and then knocking off the Bearcats of Northwest Missouri State on Saturday. And you kind of set the stage well. It was kind of a rough start in the sense that you were shorthanded and finding out early in the morning, and that just throws off everything. I mean, now you have your shoot-arounds, but obviously half your team was up earlier probably than they would normally get up on a Saturday, and it just changes routines, and that can be challenging. And then when you're without a starter and you're starting post player, how did that affect things? Did you have to change your game plan at the last minute? Or, I mean, obviously Jesse came in and played really, really well. But how does that affect everything with all those extenuating circumstances that happened Saturday morning?
Well, and they were up about 3 hours earlier.
Yeah, I'm sure.
We didn't change our game plan any. We ran a lot of the same things. It did change our rotation where we had Clary playing five and four and moving her around, and we were basically rotating Katie and Clary and Jesse, kind of like we did early when we played K-State without Liv. And they did both of them play. Jesse had a good game. Clary was solid and hit a big three for us. Katie did her normal. And it's a good thing. those three scored 39 out of our 50 points, and it was a good thing that we have good depth in the post, because you lose your Liv is she can score in bunches, and she's really good against Northwest. You lose that 13-14 points a game and a high percentage. Mm-hmm. So. You just hate to not have her be able to play, but the other kids stepped up and we got it done.
And, give Northwest credit. They hit some big shots. They had 17 made baskets. 10 were three-pointers. I think 5 of their first 6 were threes. I kind of kept them in it. I mean, you felt you're playing well, but the three-point shot's the great equalizer, and they were able to kind of stay within striking distance because of that.
Well, especially early in the second quarter, because we had them locked down. First quarter they score 6 points, and then sometimes you just relax a little bit, or you're a step slow, you're a little tired, whatever. They hit two or three threes and kind of got them back to within 4 or 5, and I think it ended up maybe 7 at half, maybe 6 at half, where it could have easily been 12 or 14. So they're a good 3-point shooting team. I mean, if you look at their percentages, they have two or three that shoot up there at 40 or better, and that's their game. They get it. They like to get it in the lane and stop and look around and kick it out and shoot a three. And if you don't help a little bit, they're efficient enough inside to score. So it gave us some trouble. And but still, I mean, we held them to 46 points. We didn't guard in the last play. My design, I said, whatever you do, they're shooting a three, just stay away from them so we don't let them score a 4-point play. And so really, our defense won that game for us. And rebounding, I mean, it was a battle. Again, you lose, you lose one of your good rebounders. But that's why it's a team game. It's not an individual deal. You need depth on your team to avoid avoid an upset because you're missing a player or two, or you have a few people that are under the weather, and so you just have to try to move on. Sometimes you're able to do it, sometimes you're not.
I loved your comment after the game about that three-pointer to win a one-point game. You've been 0-3, and now you can put that to bed. You've won a one-point game this season.
I wanted that to go in so bad, just so when people say, boy, you can't win a one-point game. No, you're wrong. We can. We can win a one-point game. So it's just our last three home games have been 1-point games.
That's crazy, isn't it?
Kearney and
Middle West. And the good teams.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like Northwest is scary. I mean, they lost the day before to Kearney by one, and Central Missouri beat, and they lost to them by one. So they're sitting at home talking about this just the way I am about 1-point games.
You mentioned Jesse Salik, 10 points, 8 boards, got the start, played almost 26 minutes, which is for her a little more than she normally does. But it's good to see her have a good game. You needed her, too, with Olivia being out for everything we chronicled. And, boy, she really, really stepped up to the task and gave you solid minutes. That was good to see.
Well, it absolutely is. And it's just amazing how a kid's mindset will change sometimes when she knows absolutely that, hey, I got to bring it today. My teammates are counting on me, and if I don't, we're going to get beat. You know, and all of a sudden, she plays with a little more urgency, and I hope that just propels her on the rest of the season because Jessie, she's a very humble person, and she doesn't understand even how good she really is, how talented she is. She's skilled. I mean, she'd be skilled if she was a guard. She's skilled for a five man. She can do things that other five men can't do. And sometimes you just got to believe it about yourself. But she's just not like that. She's so under the radar type of quiet. Like no shucks, aw shucks. Like no, Jesse, you can be really good all the time. And sometimes I think she just needs to believe that about herself.
That turnaround jump shot, and that's probably one of the areas that she is unique for a five. That little 10-foot turnaround is hard to defend. And when it doesn't go in, I find myself amazed because you expect it to fall every, like, 90%. It's an amazing shot that I think makes her unique. When she's going up against bigger post players, she's able to get that turnaround off. It's hard to defend.
Well, it is, and she doesn't shoot it enough. She keeps wanting to – she says, well, I want to change it up and come back. No, just why?
It's working well.
Yeah. I mean, you just bust it on people more often. But, again, she does – well, I don't want to shoot it. I don't want to shoot it too. She's sometimes not selfish enough. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, she's got a unique little shot in there. Nobody else in the league shoots that shot. And it's accurate. And the thing about it is the misses are all right around the rim. So it gives people like Katie and Clary and Kate Dilsaver, they know it's going to – they crash hard because they know it's going to be in about a five-foot arc in there if it doesn't go in because it's a soft shot and it doesn't venture too far away from the rim.
Well, the Tigers get the split at home. They win 50-49 over Northwest Missouri State. Now they're getting set to hit the road this week. Thursday, Saturday, they'll be Thursday night in Wichita to take on the Newman Jets. That's always a fun game. Always a lot of Tiger fans there. And then on Saturday afternoon in Edmond, Oklahoma to take on the UCO Broncos. Tiger Talk brought to you by Adams Brown. Going above and beyond for you. Adams Brown, their strategic allies and CPAs. We're back with more Tiger Talk from Big Smoke Barbecue in downtown Hayes on the Tiger Sports Network, built by PwC.
Ready to discover something new? The next time you're in your car, tune your radio to 94.3 FM.
It's here.
It's Hayes' greatest hits.
Love it.
On 1400 KAYS and 94.3 FM.
Do you believe in love? Glory days. Well,
as I'm 94.3 FM, KAYS. Go ahead. Check us out.
Fournays has the ball up by two with 3:18 to go. Here's a kick in the corner. Stearns for three. She buried it from the left wing. Timeout, Tigers. Ellie Stearns hits her second three-pointer of the game. She has 8, and the Tiger lead grows to 5 at 43-38. That was a big three on Saturday for Ellie. Big in a lot of ways. Obviously pushed your lead to 5. Northwest was hanging around, but big for her. She'd been struggling, something like 1 of 11 over the last 5 mm-hmm. games. And you kind of mentioned it in postgame, and we've seen it a lot with true freshmen. I mean, this is about the time of the year, the high school season, as far as games played and all that would come to an end. And so now they're having to kind of push through that. And maybe she's broken through at 2 big threes in that ball game. And she's such a good shooter. That was good to see. And coming up with a clutch one right there at that point of the game.
Well, it was. And she didn't hesitate. And I've told her before, you know, shooters shoot. And you can't stop shooting just because you haven't been hitting anything. If she's in the game, I want her to take open shots. And then I don't know if it was the next possession or two later,
she hit a two-point basket.
Nice little pull up from 15. So hopefully it kind of gets her going.
And she's, you know, doing all those other things, and you mm-hmm. know, that you can see the defense getting better, all those things freshmen try to figure out. But that's the one element she gives you and gives this team, because mm-hmm. at times the consistent three-point shooting has been a struggle. She's the one who can do that.
Well, and I've told her before, I says, first of all, you don't necessarily need to score a bunch to still be out on the floor helping us. So just concentrate on defending and crashing the board. She's a good rebounder for her position. And the other stuff, to an offensive player, it'll come. You're going to shake loose enough times and find enough shots. You don't need to force anything. Just do the other things and let the game come to you a little bit.
Well, hopefully that's a good sign as she gets going, as the Tigers get ready to hit the road. Going to need those threes this week. They mm-hmm. travel to Newman in Wichita, take on the Jets. And then Saturday, Central Oklahoma, the Broncos, and become two big games against teams that are – I mean, there's a clear division in the MIAA, mm-hmm. upper half and lower half, and Newman and UCR in that lower half. But yet, as we've seen – capable teams, and when they play well, and if you don't play well, they can clip you, and that becomes a challenge this week, I would think.
Yeah, we've got six teams that are up there, and you know, the seventh place team's four games back. So we do have a more of a separation than normal, but all I have to do is remind our team that Newman beat Emporia State, mm-hmm. and Emporia State was up on us 25-10. So any team can still get you if you're not prepared and if you're not ready to go. And so we know they'll be excited about playing us in Wichita. And then obviously down in Central Oklahoma, that'll be a dogfight. I don't care what the record is. They're very athletic and capable of beating anybody down there.
Yeah, no doubt. And then seems like every time you go there, it's a knockdown, drag out. It seems like it's usually been later in the year, and there's been something on the line. It ends up being a big game, but you're right. It seems like it doesn't matter. It comes down to the wire, maybe the last two or three possessions, and it seems like you've been able to hit a big shot or make a big play, enough of those to hold them off.
Well, we have, and we were, you know, the last few years we've had a couple of kind of local kids that –
yeah.
Seem to always play really good down there, so we don't this year we have Clary who played for them last year, so that's a little added incentive for her, and so that means she'll probably be tense and worthless, but I'm hoping
Hopefully not.
She played fine against them before. She's mentally tough enough. So.
And the game in Wichita is always fun. The Katie Wagner fan club usually shows up because mm-hmm. playing at May South, but there's always a lot of – I mean, it's a great environment. There's a lot of Fort Hays State fans that show up for the game, and it should be a lot of fun.
Well, it's a great environment for our game. I think usually there's nobody there, but
yeah, exactly.
We'll have the majority of the fans at that game, and that's good. And now we have Ellie down there, so we have two Wichita area kids that are playing a lot for us. So – it's a fun game for them. It's kind of like a home away from home game. So they always look forward to that.
So that'll be a lot of fun coming up on Thursday, 5:30 in Wichita, Fugate Gymnasium against the Newman University Jets. Certainly hope you can join us here. 5:05, our broadcast with the Auto World pregame here on the Tiger Sports Network. I know, time to let you go. 12:30, got to move on, but you want to make a very happy birthday wish today.
Yeah, it's my daughter's birthday, Sam, and it was a snowy day just like this when it happened, and that's one reason why we were at the hospital 14 hours early, because I didn't know if my baby delivery skills were probably where they needed to be at that time. So, anyway, happy birthday, Sam.
Well, you probably made the right choice, and it was nice to see Sam at the game at Missouri Western earlier mm-hmm. this year. Happy birthday, Sam. Coach, as always, appreciate the time. Have a great week of practice. We'll see you down in Wichita on Thursday.
Okay, thanks, Troy.
There you go. It's Tony Hobson, coach of the Fort Hays State women. We will take a break. We've got more Tiger Talk right after this with head coach Mark Johnson on the Tiger Sports Network, built by PwC.
That was another legend on 99 KZ Country. And, yes, before that, we had a brand new artist. Your home for today's stars and the legends. We play real country. I'm Teresa Trapp. Weather, news, sports, it's all here. We're on Facebook, and there is a Listen Live link at hayspost.com. Dial us in on your radio at 99.5 FM. KHAZ, real country. 99 KZ Country.
Inbound to Hammocky. He's across midcourt. 2 seconds ago. Blast all the way down the lane, and he hits a layup at the horn. Caleb Hammocky goes coast. expires, and the Tigers take a 32-19 lead into the halftime locker room. Yeah, that was some of the action from Thursday as the Fort A State men knock off Northwest Missouri State 75-48. Welcome back to Tiger Talk. It's brought to you in part today by BTI, your John Deere dealer. They've got locations in Buckland, Great Bend, Greensburg, Hoxie, Ness City, and Pratt. Online, BTIEquip.com. BTI, our family in partnership with your family. We're live at Big Smoke Barbecue at the corner of 8th and Main here in downtown Hayes. They're open 11 to 8 Monday through Saturday. Hey, it's cold all day today. Stop on by, get some carryout. BigSmokeHayes.com. Get that order in. Take it home. Have some great barbecue to warm you up on this cold Monday here in Middle America. We're joined now by men's coach Mark Johnson, Fort Hays State. Really good games. Unfortunately, a split. They had an excellent outing to knock off the Missouri Western State Griffins, as you heard the highlight from Caleb scoring right before halftime, and then just lose a tough one by 5 to the 7th-ranked team of the country, Northwest Missouri State, and kind of asked Tony Hobson about it, just the range of emotions in two games. I mean, your guys really played well in both of them, and you get the split, and you feel great on Thursday, and kind of kicked in the got a little bit on Saturday, but a really good effort, I thought, in both games by your team. Really left it out there on the floor.
Yeah, you know, I think the last three games, Emporia State, and then this past week, I mean, our guys have really taken that effort and that defense to that next level, you know, and we're playing about as well as you can defensively in the last three games. And, you know, Emporia, I don't remember what we held them to, 50, low 50s, and got some of that late. We were up big, and then held Missouri Western under 50, and really defensively, we I don't know if you can do any better than we did against Northwest. We really shut them out. They had 22 points off our turnovers, and you know, you take that away, they don't come close to 50. But I thought we played well on Thursday, played good offense, made 10 threes, and then obviously on Saturday was a rough offensive performance. And again, that wasn't all on us. Northwest, you know, they contributed to us struggling. Their style of defense, you know, we only got 12 threes off. We got probably 4 of those off in the last minute 20. I mean, they really try to take away threes and not let you beat you from threes. You have to be able to put the ball on the floor and make plays. I would say that's probably a weakness of ours. You know, Caleb obviously can do that. But when he's doing that, he's doing it against Diego Bernard, who's probably the most physical, best athletic, gifted guard in the country that's doing that. So it makes it hard on him. And then you know, our other guys were just not really great drivers. So I think there's a lot to contribute to our struggles offensively. Obviously, we need to play better. You know, we have played really pretty good the last three games, and we're about 3 turnovers away from being great the last three games, and just couldn't get it done.
And you talk about Northwest and just seeing them the first time, and I know we talked before the ball game about this, and then seeing them Saturday. It's probably the defense that has taken the next step.
Yeah.
I mean, they're obviously they're a different team than they've been the last several years, just the way they go about it and their makeup. But, man, a lot of those turnovers, I mean, they were getting in passing lanes,
yeah.
Getting handsy, I think I called them. They disrupt a lot. Their defense has gotten really good.
Yeah, you know, you look at and this might be by design. You know, you look at their team. I didn't talk to Ben about it, but – those guys have been in the program for a long time. Those guys have had long seasons because they've played in the national championship game however many years in a row. And really, they were talented enough until about 2.5-3 weeks ago. They won on offense. If you look statistically, because scoring defense is overrated, their pace of play. But you look at their opponent's field goal percentage, the three-point field goal percentage, they were dead last, 14 out of 14 mm-hmm. through 10 conference games, 9, whatever it may be. And they were just being able to still win because they're so good offensively. And now they've turned the screws up on defense, and now they've gone from 14 statistically in all those categories. I think they're already up to 7. Mm-hmm. They've passed half the teams. And like I said, looking back, I'm not so sure maybe that wasn't by design. It's hard to ask your guys to grind out another season. And I think now they're starting to turn it up and kind of getting that postseason is getting closer, and we got to start getting sharper in what we do. And no question, they're guarding a lot better. And I think I think we're guarding better. A lot of times going back, looking the game, you know, Ian was, we kind of had to play different personnel that didn't allow us maybe to guard as well as we can now. Mm-hmm. And I think both teams are playing better than that first matchup.
Well, and I mean, boy, we talked about it after the game as well. Another one, you're right there. I mean, your guys are in a position and had a couple good-looking threes that may have tied it late. They didn't go, but, I mean – You've been as close as anybody against these guys now the last four times out. And even before that, you were competitive games and you were in it. It's just a matter of getting over the hump. Maybe you'll get to meet them again. Who knows? But I don't know if you can take any solace in that. But it's a results in business. But your guys do. You match up and there's no fear factor and they go at them head to head.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of teams – I mean, our guys are – we're not going to get – out toughed and out hustled or out usually. I mean, the other team's not going to play any harder than us. Now I will say what happens to us at times, we don't have another level to go against Northwest. Yeah. You know, we're playing Missouri Western and Emporia to win those games with the same level we have to try to go beat Northwest. I think some of these other teams that may be upset Emporia or in Northwest. They take it to another level that they haven't been playing at all year. Our guys, to our guys' credit, I mean, they bring it pretty much every night. And, but, yeah, you know, usually what happens is the guy that's the best player on the floor that night in those type of close games ends up winning. Obviously, Diego, by far, was the best player on the floor. You look at our other close games, Northeastern State here, overtime win. We win the game. Who was the best? Caleb had 36. He was phenomenal. And that was probably, honestly, the difference in the game was Diego. He was just that much better than whoever was our best guy. Obviously, our best guy was Caleb, I think, that night. But that's kind of what happens. You know, he got some big finishes and made some big plays against us that we had a hard time handling.
Yeah, career high 29. I actually thought you defended him fairly well. You made him take a lot of shots, but he got to the line a lot, got a lot of them there. But, man, he is special.
Yeah, for sure. And like I said, I mean, they're starting to – just shows you how great they've been. I mean, his first 4 years there, he's been their third or fourth option.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? And, I mean, that's how – like sometimes people forget. You realize how – we all realize how good Ryan Hawkins, Trevor Hutchins, and those guys are. I think what Ben's done a great job of is guys like Diego willing to accept being the third or fourth option when they could go to everybody else in the league and be the number one option. I think that is probably what I think Ben has probably done the best there, because everybody can X and O to some degree. You know how to get your guys to play harder. Some do better than others, whatever. But I mean, I think what he's done probably as good as anybody is having guys that talented accept their roles. And that's a challenge, especially in today's world, and he's done a great job with that.
We did have a question emailed to us here this morning. It involves Diego Bernard. Again, you can chime in. Go to FHSUathletics.com. Click on fans. You'll get a drop down there in the bottom. Ask the coach, and if we use the question, you'll be in the running for a $25 gift certificate here from Big Smoke. And does he have a chance to play in the NBA? My guess is he's not quite big enough. I mean, he's talented, but obviously a pretty big step.
No, he's 6 foot. If he was 6'4", yeah. But, I mean, I would say he has a better chance of playing in the NFL. You know, there was talk of him, because he's using a COVID year, there was talk all last offseason or throughout the season that he was going to go use his COVID year and go Division I somewhere and play football. I don't know, but he would NBA. You're not going to play. He doesn't shoot it well enough, and he's 6 foot. There's no 6 foot guys playing in the NBA. Athletically, yes.
Yeah.
But I would be interested. If I was him, I would go to an NFL. And you know, obviously, he's got to get a little bit bigger, get him in a weight program. But I mean, athletically. Whew. I mean, you put him, I don't know, a cornerback, safety. I don't know how, if you haven't no experience, I'm not well-schooled enough to know if that's a possible transition or if there's a slot receiver. I don't know. But I think athletically he would have a chance at that. I think NBA, he's just undersized. He'd have to be – if he was 6'4 to 6'6", he would. But at 6'1", probably not.
He's good. He put on quite a show. And certainly Northwest needed every one of his 29 points to escape with that victory on Saturday afternoon. Tiger Talk is brought to you in part by the Hayes Orthopedic Institute. Expertise, technology, compassion, all right here. Hayes Med Orthopedic Institute, where you can regain your your best moves. No need to travel far. Hayes Orthopedic Institute, they're the official team physicians of the Fort Hays State Tigers. We will take a break. More Tiger Talk with Mark Johnson next on the Tiger Sports Network, built by PwC. Here's Lucas Hammacki into the front court. Down the lane to the rim, and he put it in. They left the lane open, and the Northwest Missouri State Bearcats call a timeout as Lucas Hammacki drives it all the way down to put them up by five. Yeah, nice play by Lucas on Saturday. Tigers got out to a 10-point lead over the 7th-ranked Bearcats, but lose a tough one, 57-52. Welcome back to Tiger Talk. We're live at Big Smoke Barbecue at the corner of 8th and Main in Hayes. If you can't come by for lunch, of course, you can always order to go, BigSmokeHayes.com. Get some carryout on your way home from work tonight on a cold Monday here in Hayes, America. We haven't really talked about the Western game, and you talk about the difference in the two. You played well, you played hard, you hit 10 threes in that game, and that's kind of when your team is able to do that. I know they're different teams, but that was kind of the difference, and you end up having a game in which you got a comfortable lead, had a great first half, and it was nice to see because those have been hard to come by with this group. It's usually a grinding battle down to the last couple of possessions, and nice to have one that wasn't that way.
Yeah, you don't win very many games by over 20 in the MIAA, and yeah, we played well. We shot the ball. We made a big difference. We made 10 threes. And at St. Joe, at one point, we missed 18 straight. Obviously, we ran better offense, got better looks. Thought our defense was really high, you know, and that led to some better opportunities. And, like, you know, most people we play, you know, I feel like our guys play at a really hard physical level. The other team usually is going to try to match that. What you try to do is keep doing it, and the teams that aren't used to doing that eventually can't do it for 40 minutes, and you kind of see that. You know, we kind of broke away, got a 13-point lead, and then we kind of break them in the second half. And that's what I think, just by consistently playing hard, you know, especially on our arena, we're going to get everybody's best effort. And I don't want it any other. Don't get me wrong, I don't want to be changed. But, I mean, when they walk, it's like Northwest Missouri is never going to come out here and not be ready to play. You come into our environment, we got a great arena, and we got a good crowd. Well, that automatically gives the other team, gets them juiced up. Kind of like, you know, hear about football. Hey, emotions can only carry you maybe the first possession. Then it comes down to, you know, do what you do. You know, I thought against Western, we played harder throughout, which forced them to have to play harder, and then they hit a breaking point and couldn't do it anymore. At their place, we didn't make them do it. You know, we played pretty hard, but not to the effort we did this past three games, where same thing in Poria, they hung around the first half, and then our guys eventually broke them. But it's because they're like, we're not used to being able to have to do this. Our guy, hey, we've had this group's a rarity last year and this year. These guys play as hard and as physical and as tough, especially on the defensive end, as any team we've ever had. And there's not a lot of people that can do that. You know, we always talk about talent and shooting, ball hand, quickness, jumping, but talent gets overlooked so many times. Not everybody can play as hard as these guys play. Mm-hmm. You know, not everybody can be as tough as these guys are. You know what I mean? And so they're a unique group with that. I think, you know, you have spells, you have groups, maybe this high offense, or you do this or you do that. This group, the last 2 years, their success is going to be based off how hard they play and how tough they are.
And I think the Tiger fans have come to appreciate that. And you know, maybe it's not going to be 80 points every game and a lot of high flying and dunking, but I think the fans have appreciated the effort, and you've seen it grown over the years. I mean, the applause for players, and it's mainly but what they've been doing on the defensive end and those little things.
Yeah, you know, you just, when you have, like I said, Gabe and B, you look like, I see the Owen Long kid had 30-something the other night. I mean, Gabe just totally take him out of the game. Yeah. You know, those two guys, honestly, are probably the two best defenders we've had in 20 years, and they're here together. So you kind of feel like that's where you got to base your team off. Mm-hmm. Is it a struggle at times sometimes on the offensive end? Sure. But that's the best way we're going to win with those guys. And it's just like everything. Sometimes, hey, we got really good big guys, so we're going to be a pounded inside team. Or this group, we have our best way of winning is we have great guards, play fast, shoot threes. Craig Nicholson, we got to get up-tempo. You know, so you kind of got to go to what you have. And I think with this current group, that this is the best way for them to be successful. And then when you're trying to do that, the worst thing you can do is bring in a couple guys in your recruiting class that don't play hard. And now that damages everything you're trying to do. So a lot of Ian, hard-playing guy. You know, I mean, when we brought Jeff in, hard-playing guy. I mean, all these guys we've kind of added of late will kind of add to that. And so it's been a good group to coach. They're fun to coach as far as the effort and that they're going to bring every day, and they're going to try to do right, and winning is important to them.
You mentioned the best player on the floor. A lot of times you win. That was on Thursday. Caleb, 25 points. 10 of 13 from the floor, hit all three threes, both of his free throws. He had six assists and one turnover, and he really struggled against the Western length in St. Joe, and they're still a long team, but you kind of alluded to it after the game. That was a nice breakthrough game for him to kind of figure out how to combat that and get his shots off, and he had one of those games. He was on fire.
Yeah, he played great again. You know, it was really the last couple games against, you know, we felt like there was ways to get our guards closer to the rim. You know, we got Caleb against Reese Glover and some of those guys, and we able Caleb and Elijah aren't the tallest guys. They're 6'1 and 6'3, but they're both physical guys. And you know, Caleb was really able to get against those guys inside the paint. You look at Elijah at Emporia, and what happens is you make a few easy shots, you kind of get stuff to the rim, that your confidence builds, and now you start making your perimeter shots. You know, Elijah hit a three at Emporia, and that's what you try to press on your team. Look at the Washburn game, Levi Brown. You can't let players get off early. It gets their confidence going, and they don't. If you sit there and make the first 10 minutes of the game really hard on their best players like we did at Emporia, and didn't let Reese Glover and these guys get loose from three like we did at their place. Now when they do get an open shot later in the game, they don't make it because they don't have that confidence. You let these guys get off early, boom. And I think Caleb did a good job of finding a way to get some easy baskets early. Confidence grows. You start making your perimeter shots.
No doubt. And that certainly made for a great game. One of his better games, certainly at Gross Memorial Coliseum. He didn't get to play a lot on Saturday because of foul trouble. I think Gilbert Peters has been giving you some really good minutes, and not just this weekend, but really last three or four or five games. It feels like he's gone to a little bit different level for you guys.
Yeah, I would say, you know, that's the last three games. To me, the reason our defense is just two. One, our effort has gone from a 9-9 to a 10. And then Gilbert and Ian are getting over there, attacking the ball. And it's not necessarily not their man when someone's coming down the lane. They're making ours. The reason Diego is talented, is he athletic. He was 8 of 22 from the field. Those guys are getting there. I thought a big key to the game, we were up 20-10, and Gilbert got in foul trouble. Yep. And then Ian got in foul trouble right after that, and we had to do some subbing because we couldn't run out of bodies in the second half. But I think Gilbert's played really well. You know, Gilbert, we'd like to get him the ball more. It's a little bit harder to get him the ball than, say, Ian or Brady Worth. You know, he's not quite as tall. You know, he's not nearly as long. You know, Gilbert is kind of the opposite. He's 6'6 and a half, but probably has the wingspan of a 6'4 guy, where Brady was 6'7, had the wingspan of a 6'10 guy. And then Gilbert isn't a guy that can, like Brady them could, that could Jared catch it 8 feet from the goal, back themselves down, and now get them in position. Gilbert kind of has to catch the ball already in position. So it's been a struggle. You know, I think he had you know, four or five shots. We'd really like to get him up to 8 or 9. It's just that's a challenge. It's not as easy to get him the ball as your typical big. But we need to do a better job. He needs to do a better job. Our perimeter players need to do a better job. And us as coaches probably need to do a better job of getting him a few more touches than he is right now.
Well, hopefully that will happen. And Fort Day State's going to need everybody on deck as they hit the road this week. Wichita, then Edmond, Oklahoma. We'll take our final break. We'll preview the Newman Jets and the Central Oklahoma Broncos, who, by the way, lead the MIAA. We'll do that when we return. One final break here on this Monday. You're listening to Tiger Talk on the Tiger Sports Network, built by PwC. possession is stolen. B gets it back. He's going to shoot a three. He hammered it in! Piatti Janssen knocked in the left corner three, and it's a two-point game, 54-52. The ball was nearly stolen. Janssen got it back and buried the three-pointer. Yeah, got the Tigers close on Saturday. Had a couple of good looks. A possession later, couldn't get them to go, and they lose by 5 to number 7 Northwest Missouri State. But who knows, maybe get a chance to play them again. Welcome back to Tiger Talk, our final segment here. Fort A State on the road. They'll be at Newman, who's tied for the bottom of the conference standings on Thursday, and then go to Edmond to take on Central Oklahoma, who leads the MIAA. Obviously, a big challenge Saturday, but a big challenge Thursday. Newman's one of those teams, the wins haven't been there, but yet, man, you watch them play. They've got some talent. They've got some athleticism. And, boy, they got a small arena. You know it's going to be a loud crowd. Fort A State's a big draw for them. Tigers will have a lot of fans there. Tough place to play. It's going to be two tough road games for you guys this week.
Yeah, I mean, you look at last year. I mean, we won it in the last 2 minutes or a minute. I think Nige hit a three with a minute five to kind of close the game out. We have had success. We've only lost one time there, but they've all, for the most part, been at the very end. This is our league's just different. You know, I mean, if you're in another league and you're playing the bottom team with the record-wise, you probably have a really, really good chance of winning. I mean, this will be a hard game, and if we don't play well, we will lose. At our place, kind of like the Western game, was really one of our best games. We made shots. We played extremely well to get separation, ended up winning by 20, but we played great. Very athletic. They'll pressure you. They got a really talented guard in the Stevie Strong kid. Got good size. So it'll be a hard game. Then obviously Central Oklahoma, I think, is probably even better than a year ago because they're pretty consistent on both ends of the ball. So it'll be a tough road trip, like you say.
Oops, see what happens. We'll be on the air 5:05 with the women's game on Thursday from Fugate Gymnasium in Wichita. Fort A State to Newman, then 1:05 Saturday from Edmond, Oklahoma, Hamilton Fieldhouse. The Tigers taking on Central Oklahoma. Coach, appreciate the time as always. Have a good week of practice, and we'll see you Thursday night in Wichita.
All right, thanks, Gerard.
That's Mark Johnson, coach of the Tigers. Again, the program brought to you this afternoon by Golden Bell Bank of Hayes and Ellis, Adams Brown, the Taco Shop, BTI, the Hayes Orthopedic Institute, and, of course, our title sponsor and our host, Big Smoke Barbecue, corner of 8th and Main in Hayes. If you missed any part of the program, you can always watch back the replay. It'll be up tomorrow on HayesPost.com. For the coaches, this is Gerard Welbrock. So long, everyone.